Welcome to Real Estate Power Podcast. My name is JB Bolvedon, founder and CEO of Tilray Success Solutions, a Grant Cardone licensee. And I have with me a very special guest, David Ilkay, team leader of the Valderrama Ilkay team, who's actually won multiple awards and is one of the powerhouses in New York. David, welcome to the show.
Thank you, JB. Thanks for having me here.
It's my pleasure. So I really love your story because there's a lot of work and dedication that gets you where you need to go. And how did you actually get into real estate? What brought you here?
It's a very interesting story. One day I was at a car wash, and it was late in April, not too many people there. And just waiting for my car to be dried up, and then I see this car coming out from the tunnel. And I realize it's a Bentley. You know, I like cars, especially Bentleys. So the car came up from the tunnel, and I'm walking around the car, and this gentleman approaches me, and he goes, "You like the car?" I said, "Of course, it's a nice car." And then he goes, "Here's my card. If you want to get one, give me a call." So that was it. I mean, I went to his office. He was a real estate broker, very professional guy, and he, you know, told me how to get my license and start. And it started from there, and that's it.
Wow, and what were you doing before you got that start?
Since I was a kid, I always do, you know, I love sales. As a matter of fact, when I was 6 years old, I turned my sister's crib into a stand in the house and sold guests the household items we have. So since then, I got you know, law education, then I got my MBA in New York, but I always wanted to sell, and then I thought, you know, what's the biggest thing you can sell, and end up with house sales, basically.
So that was the biggest ticket item and had the highest.
Biggest ticket item, and it's so much fun to see people their reaction, especially first time home buyers.
Yeah,
you know. It's very satisfying job, basically.
For sure. Now, when you're working with clients, especially when you first got started, what was your like biggest goal? Like, what did you want to accomplish personally, and did you accomplish it? And did you accomplish it in the speed you wanted to?
Like anything else I do, I try to be my best, and you know, always improve myself. Actually, when I first started, I didn't even know what the, you know, colonial house or Cape house mean, and so I had to educate myself very quickly before, you know, embarrass myself. But when you don't know things, you learn very quickly.
Yeah.
And especially if you want to make it, you know, I worked day and night about the, you know, terms, learn the terms of the real estate, how to talk to people, and all that. It took me like a year actually to get my first award from the beginning, because I think I'm a personable person, and that makes a huge difference. When you talk to people, you know, they trust you, and when they trust you, they start doing business with you.
Yeah, totally. That's so important. And so, and what was the, when you were actually, because how many years total have you been in real estate now?
I started real estate with the crash of 2008.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing. People were telling me, why are you going to the real estate market right now? And I said, nobody left, so maybe I go in and fill the spot. But yeah, 2008 to today, and very active, I would say almost 7 days a week.
And when did you start actually like building out a team? When did you go from just being a solo to having your own group?
I always had my partners, like single partners. Why? Because I want to have a coverage of, you know, different backgrounds, different genders, like male, female, young, old. So you
right.
cover, you know, larger amount of people that, you know, if somebody doesn't want to work with you, they might want to work with your partners.
Right.
So
that makes sense.
Yeah.
And what would you say to the agent that's trying to do it all by themselves right now? Do you think that's a good idea to continue that way?
If you are a new agent, I would suggest that you get a mentor, at least if you don't want to join a team. But joining a team is, you know, has many advantages. First of all, you can learn from experienced people. This is not a classroom learning. This is like real life. If you have a real life question, you get an answer right away, and then you take it from there. I see a lot of agents trying to do everything by themselves. They struggle, and then struggle comes with the frustration. And once you are frustrated, many people leave the field, and you never see them again.
Yeah. For sure. And what do you think your biggest struggle was when you, as you were growing?
My biggest struggle was how to learn to educate my clients and customers, because they have to know what you're offering them, your value. So this is very important to explain it to them, for them to trust and do business with you.
Yeah.
If you are simply saying, I'm in real estate business, I want to sell your home, nobody's going to work with you. But you have to show them what values you bring to the table.
Right.
Then, you know, you can work with them and, you know, they trust you.
Yeah. And this is actually because we talked about this outside of here. I mean, is there a place for being humble as a business owner, especially as a real estate agent?
I mean, for me to be humble, of course, being humble is a good thing. But certain places, maybe, you know, your place of worship, you can be humble. Within your family, you can be humble. But when it comes to business, if you're humble, nobody's gonna know who you are and what you do. So in business, I prefer to, you know, brag about myself, what I did, and what can I do for them. That's how you distinguish yourself from others.
Yeah, for sure. Because look, if you won't brag about yourself, who's going to brag about you?
Exactly. Exactly.
And it's a form of marketing. You have to actually educate people and get it out there.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, and I'm really glad you said that, because you're the only person that we've interviewed so far that's actually brought that up, because it's, you have to be your best advocate and your own advocate, because that's actually what creates the value in the marketplace.
Exactly.
For you.
I mean, we don't want to mix this up with being arrogant.
Of course not. Yeah.
You just have to, you know, just tell about your experience, you know, what you did, what you can do for them. This has nothing to being arrogant. This is just explaining yourself to other people.
Right. Right. And then for the person who is intelligent, motivated, has a lot of potential, but they haven't actually sold anything yet. They're brand new. How do they actually go out to that marketplace with that level of confidence, but they don't have necessarily the track record yet? Well, what would you recommend to them?
My biggest recommendation about business, fake it until you make it. So I got this agent recently. We hired an agent. He's a young guy, and he's very motivated. And I told him, don't box yourself, right? Meaning like, don't let anybody tell you you're young, you don't have experience.
Right.
You can show them you are knowledgeable at any age, it can be any age, and then you can give them value.
Right.
And believe it or not, within 2 months starting the business, he has his first deal, first under contract, and he keeps going, because we talk about it, I said you have to deal with your frustrations first in this business. You know, because business, the way the nature of the business, even you get a deal today, you have to wait at least 60, 70, 80 days for that deal to be closed. But don't get obsessed with one deal. You keep filling up your queue. When the deal closes, it closes. But you have many coming after that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Most agents, they make one deal and then they obsess about that deal.
Yeah.
And when the deal falls through, they fall through with that.
That's right. You know? Yeah. It's because they have an empty pipeline. So
exactly.
Like it's a big deal because it's their only deal. And that's not how you can actually build a career out of this. And I think that's really important, that I'm glad you brought that up, because a lot of agents out there, what they're doing is that they're just targeting one thing, they're obsessing with it, and then every small thing that goes wrong becomes a crisis for them.
Exactly.
They can't function properly, and the biggest problem is they're just not filling their pipeline.
I always tell my agents, if you have 10 deals you're doing at the same time, even 5 of them falls through, you still have another 5.
Yeah.
So that's the name of the game. Otherwise, if you have one deal and if anything happens to that, then you're out.
Yeah, yeah. So you have to actually expand. And that's what you've done too with your career. In addition to growing a team and expanding that, you've also gotten into the real estate investing game as well.
Exactly. I always like to improve myself as a person. So I don't want to stand still with just being a real estate agent. Then I realized that there's a huge market for investments, especially, you know, short sales, auctions. Once you know the business, the end of the business, and end side of the business, learning beginning side of the business is not that difficult.
Right.
Like how to buy the houses in a short sale or auctions, and then how to fix them, what to fix, actually, the layout. Because you have the experience from your buyers. Each time you do open house, they come to the house and they say, oh, this should have been here, that should have been there.
Right.
So you have ideas that you can apply to your investment properties.
So, and how many investment properties do you say you do about a year? What do you prefer to do? What's your targets?
With my partners and investors, we do up to 30, 40 properties a year.
Wow.
And this starts with either auction properties. We go to auctions, we buy properties from the auction, or we have short sale companies that, you know, provide us with the short sale deals.
Right.
And from that, fixing it, putting in the market, and selling it.
Yeah. So I mean that's basically have a machine here. It creates like there's a consistency here.
Yes, JB. Yeah. It becomes a machine once you start. Once people know you're in this type of business.
Yeah.
When they have a deal, they call you. They say, you know, we have this. Would you be interested in? And from experience, you will be able to tell them, yes, I can do this very quickly. You don't have to waste time, their time, your time.
Right.
You know what you are getting into, and that's it.
Then they can actually roll and get bigger.
Yep.
That's fantastic. That's really good. And then what's the next step now? Like in 5 years, what is your business look like, you think?
My business, as we are all getting old, I'm not going to be able to run around like this, you know, so much. But my goal is to get some rental properties for the future. That's going to generate income. And I like big commercial properties, such as, you know, the bank buildings, or I'm not going to say strips anymore because strips are losing money. I have friends that they own like many strips. Now, you know, the business is changing with internet.
Right.
Everybody's online, purchasing online. Small businesses, for them, is hard to survive. But of course, the bank's gonna always need a physical location. That's if you have a bank as a, you know, tenant, you're set for your life, basically.
Yeah, because if they go, a lot of bad things are happening in this world, right? If
it always, the banks, yeah. Always, yeah.
Yeah, so that's actually great. So now you're looking to transition to holding properties now over time and creating more cash flow, not just from these flips, but from rental income.
Yes, flips are the, you know, short-term deals.
Yeah.
Obviously, the shorter you make them, is better for you.
Yeah.
But of course, besides that, you're gonna need a long-term investments.
Yeah.
That's gonna generate income for you. For the, you know, bad times or when you're older and you cannot just function as much as like before.
Right, right. Well, it's definitely better than putting your money in a 401k.
Oh, yes. 10 times better, like your...
like our logo here.
Logo, yeah.
Yeah. So we talked about the first-time agent, and it's very common for real estate people to transition into investing at one point or another. However, the the attrition rate of a real estate agent is over 80% in the first year, and it's even higher once they get to real estate investing, because a lot of people claim to be an investor but they can't actually pull it off because they either watch a TV show or a class, or they got some, you know, and they take this small knowledge and they get into a property and they realize this is a lot more work than I thought it would ever be. What would be your advice to a first-time real estate investor?
Well, all I can tell you is nothing like seen in TV, because in real life you're going to have many, many other factors that involve with the real estate investing, especially if you are fixing the houses. There are, you know, steps that you have to take, such as getting permits, finding contractors, and do you have to work with people that can, I'm not going to say cut corners, but cut costs for you. Because at the end, your goal is to make profit.
Right.
And I had many investors I've seen before, they take it emotionally and they emotionally become attached to their investment properties.
Right.
So, and they want to make it like as if they're going to live there.
Right.
So once you start doing that, then you're spending too much money, and then you're either cutting your profits or totally losing your profits.
Right.
And I have many, many investors that, you know, they think they are getting a good deal at the beginning. It might be, but at the end, you end up losing money because you spend so much or you didn't consider this factor, additional costs. So you end up losing money.
So you have to really look at it as a business. You can't think of it like a homeowner, which a lot of people do and get actually pulled into this. It's like a, it's like seducing real estate investors, and they go into it and they kind of get too emotionally attached, and that's what creates all the financial loss.
Exactly.
And they actually don't even know how to take a loss. Sometimes you just have to decide, okay, I'm losing, let's get rid of it, versus holding it too over a long period of time.
Yes, that's one of the mistakes they make. They obviously have a price that they have to sell to make profit.
Right.
But if you, if it's not working and if you're at that price for a long, long time, then you're going to end up losing money.
Right.
Because either your cost of money or the market changes,
right,
you might end up losing even bigger money than beginning.
Yeah. So it's important to one, you know, what's the rule Warren Buffett says? The rule number one, don't lose money. Rule number two, don't lose money.
Yeah.
Rule number three, don't lose money.
Exactly, yeah.
But if they are losing, they should cut that loss fast. And
cut the
out.
Loss fast, and like it's very cliche, but business is business, no emotions involved.
Right.
You have to make business decisions, you know, based on the market conditions.
Of course, yeah, that makes sense. So I mean, you're doing a lot of work. You've, in the last decade in real estate, you've really exploded, like from where you started to where you are today. And there's obviously something that pushes you. And what is that thing? Like, what is your purpose? Your big why? The reason why you do work so hard, you do want to grow. Like, what is that big thing that motivates you?
That's a very good question, actually. I ask myself that many times. I keep going and going. I mean, as I said, even now, 7 days a week,
yeah,
sometimes. I consider the situation a condition, actually.
Yeah.
It's like being permanently hungry, I guess,
yeah,
for business, to achieving things. And if you are taking pleasure out of what you do,
yeah,
like my pleasure when I get a flip house, for example, it's an old house, everything is falling apart. I fix it, and then people come in, seeing their reaction for the first time. That makes me proud. I said,
yeah,
wow, I did a good job. So this family who's going to spend next decade of their life here, they like it, and I give them a home,
right,
basically.
It's a win-win.
So there are things besides making money that keeps you going, such
yeah
as getting pleasure out of your work, and
yeah,
that's, I guess, what I do.
That's great. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So in closing, what I want to do is ask you, to every entrepreneur-minded person who's watching, what's the biggest piece of advice you would give them?
Biggest piece of advice is, first, before you jump into anything, get yourself educated and talk to people who are doing this already. One of my best examples I always remember and I tell people, when Americans were fighting with British, they didn't have guns or rifles.
Right.
And then one guy said, okay, we're going to fight with British. And the other one said, how? We don't even have rifles.
Yeah.
And this smart guy, he made a mold. And then, you know, like those British handmade, hand-carved rifles,
yeah,
they did them in like in number of rifles within no time.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to say, if something is right, if somebody is doing a good business, successful, there is no shame to copy them. You can copy them, you can ask them questions, you can learn from their experience. Don't try to create the wheel.
Yeah.
Right? If it's working, don't fix it.
That's phenomenal advice. We were actually talking about that before in another podcast, and I said, right now there's someone in the jungle inventing electricity.
Exactly.
But it already
yes
exists.
Yes.
You don't have to be an explorer. It already is there. That's great advice.
And that's where the education comes in, because working with experienced people, especially getting trained by experienced people, is going to make huge difference in your lives. But of course, you have to make sure that their credentials are there.
Right.
You know, they are the real people doing this, work.
Right.
Because many people try to talk about real estate, how to make money. They yell and scream on the screens, holding money. But you have to check their records or ask them to show their records.
Right.
And make sure that they are in this business, they are doing the actual business, and you can learn from them.
For sure. David Akai, thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure.
All right. That was great. We're going to see you on the next one. Plenty of guests. How do they follow you, David, as far as like online?
You can find me with my email, david.lk@element.com, or my cell phone number, 347-515-3156.
Awesome. Great. Thanks again.
Thank you.
We'll see you guys on the next one. Take care.